Good evening, everybody, and welcome to St Deniol's Church this evening for our special event, our memories of World War II. Now, having heard the rehearsal, taking part in the rehearsal today, I think you're going to find this is a very enjoyable but also very moving evening. I do have to say, first of all, that we do have some exits in case we have to evacuate the building. Leave by the door here.
Saturday, bright as a bell, early and just for the ride. He took a trip, cycling down to the sea. You and your lady and I. And oh, what a summer, oh, what a sun. Bright in the blue sky it clung. One day at Whitsun, the sea and the shore, the summer before the war. All the summer places where we could taste the country of. Racing our shadows, we fly down through the narrow lanes, chasing the slow trains, the last of an age going by. We had a good time, oh, we had some fun. There was time then, and we were all young. Day of Whitsun, the sea and the shore, the summer before the war. Young hearts and young souls, young minds to unfold, knowing the untold somehow. One day at Whitsun, the sea and the the summer before the war. We found a small cove by the sea and the water, salt brushing our skin. Your hand in her hand, there was nothing to say. Just watch the sea rushing in. And oh, what a moment, and oh, what a day. We held it, it never slipped away. One day at Whitsun, the sea and the shore, the summer before the war.
Thank you. 76,000 wounded, but a higher civilian death toll, 70,000 as opposed to 2,000 in World War I, largely due to German bombing raids during the Blitz. 40,000 civilians died in the 7-month period between September 1940 and May 1941. Almost half of them in London.
Hitler has only got one ball. Hillary has two but very small. Himmler has something similar, but poor Goebbels has no balls at all.
The Second World War by Elizabeth Jennings. Elizabeth Jennings was a prolific poet, regarded as a traditionalist rather than an innovator. She is known for her lyric poetry and mastery of form.
The Second World War. The voice said, "We are at war." And I was afraid, for I did not know what this meant. My sister and I ran to our friends next door, as if they could help. History was lessons learned with ancient dates, but here was something utterly new. The radio, called the wireless then, had said that the country would have to be brave. There was much to do. And I remember that night, as I lay in bed, I thought of soldiers who had stood on our nursery floor, holding guns, on guard and stiff. But war meant blood shed over battlefields, cavalry galloping. War on that September Sunday made us feel frightened of what the world waited for.
The Naming of Parts by Henry Reed. Henry Reed worked as a teacher and journalist until 1941 and served as a translator during the Second World War. He mimics the speech of army instructors, precisely echoing the vocal rhythms and including military jargon. The contrast between this seemingly prosaic language and the lyrical, meditative voice that also appears in the poem leads to a poignant exploration of the individual experience.
Today we have the naming of paths. Yesterday we had daily cleaning. Tomorrow morning we shall have what to do after firing. But today we have naming of paths. Japonica glistens like coral in all of the neighbouring gardens. And today we have naming of paths. This is the lower sling swivel, and this is the upper sling swivel, whose use you will see when you are given your slings. And this is the piling swivel, which in your case you've not got. The branches hold in the gardens their silent, eloquent gestures, which in our case we've not got. This is the safety catch, which is always released with an easy flick of the thumb. And please do not let me see anyone using his finger. You can do it quite easy if you have any strength in your thumb. The blossoms are fragile and motionless, never letting anyone see any of them using their fingers. And this is, you can see, is the bolt. The purpose of this is to open the breech, as you see. We can slide it rapidly backwards and forwards. We call this easing the spring. And rapidly backwards and forwards, the early bees are assaulting and fumbling the flowers. They call it easing the spring. They call it easing the spring. It is perfectly easy if you have any strength in your thumb. Like the bolt and the breech and the cocking piece and the point of balance, which in our case we have not got. And almond blossom, silent in all the gardens, and the bees going backwards and forwards. For today, we have naming of paths.
The blackout. To make it difficult for the German bombers, the British government imposed a total blackout during the war. Every person had to make sure that they did not provide any lights that would give clues to the German pilots that they were passing over built-up areas. All householders had to use thick black curtains or blackout paint to stop any light showing through their windows. Shopkeepers not only had to black out their windows, but also had to provide a means for customers to leave and enter their premises without letting any light escape. The streets were patrolled by air raid prevention officers, ARPs, shouting, "Put that light out!"
"Oh, hello. I finished me blackout. There's paint on the carpet, glue in the air, there's a sword in the bathroom, and spills on the stair, and a drawny pin there lost on the seat of the chair. But I finished me blackout. The bedrooms are draped in funeral black, except for the little one out in the back, and that we had to nail over with a sack. But I finished the blackout. Oh, I finished me blackout. Policemen and wardens may peer and may pry, and enemy planes may look down from the sky, but they won't see a pinprick, however they try, for I've finished me blackout."
In my Liverpool. exceedingly bare. If you want a cathedral, we've got one to spare in my Liverpool home.
Well, way back in the 40s, the building went mad. Mr. Hitler threw at everything that he had. When the smoke and the glass fell, cleared from the air. And Christ, said the old man, the pier ain't still there.
Exceedingly bare. If you want a cathedral, we've got one to spare in my Liverpool home. In my Liverpool home.
The Liverpool Blitz. The Liverpool, Bootle and the Wallasey Pool complex was strategically a very important location. It handled over 90% of all the war material brought into Britain from abroad, with some 75 million tonnes passing through its 11 miles. The Germans were aware of this, and Liverpool was the most heavily bombed area of the country, outside London. The first major air raid took place on the 28th of August, 1940, when 160 bombers attacked the city. This assault continued over the next 3 nights, then regularly for the rest of the year. There were 50 raids on the city during this period, some comprising 300 aircraft and lasting over 10 hours. To hide from the Germans how much damage had been inflicted upon the docks, reports on the bombing were kept low-key. Some 4,000 people were killed in the Merseyside area. This death toll was second only to London. 28th of November saw a heavy raid on the city and the most serious single incident when a hit on an air raid shelter in Derning Road caused 166 fatalities. Winston Churchill described it as the single worst incident of the year.
Born in Birkenhead in 1932, Adrian Henry trained as a painter and settled in Liverpool in 19. He associated with Roger McGough and Brian Patton as one of the Liverpool poets.
From my autobiography by Adrian Henry. Carrying my gas mask to school every day, buying saving stamps, remembering my national registration number, ZMGM1363. I can still remember it. Avoiding careless talk, digging for victory, looking for German spies everywhere. Oh yes, I did my bit for my country that long dark winter. Me and Winston and one or two others, wearing my tin hat whenever possible, and singing, "Hand out the washing on the sea, creep line." Aircraft recognition charts pinned to my bedroom wall, the smell of paint on toy soldiers, doing paintings of Spitfires and Hurricanes, Lancasters and Halifaxes, along with a Heinkel or Messerschmitt, plunging helplessly into the sea in the background. Pink light in the sky from Liverpool, burning 50 miles away. The thunder of daylight's flying fortresses high overhead, shaking the elderberry tree. Bright barrage balloons flying over the docks. morning curve of the bay, seen from the park of the hill, after coming out of the early shelter, listening for the all clear, listening to Vera Lynn, Dorothy L'Amour, Alan Jones and the Andrew sisters, clutching my father's hand, tripping over the unfamiliar curve in the blackout.
Mother of disaster and sister of all fate, do you count the tragedies we see? And father of confusion and brother of debate, do you recall the sister of Rosemary? The doodle boats were flying, Blitz was at its high, Rosemary lay sleeping, the sister only five, and no one heard the one that hit, the one that blew the lid. Rosemary came out crying, the sister never did, and you fly high, and your dreams are all in vain. Angels' wings, Rosemary's sister will be dancing. Well, her mother cried all that year, as many others did. She'd pull through for a moment now and then, and the people down in Bethel Street, in the rubble and the stones, swept up their lives and started up again. For when tyranny comes biting, you do your best to try to stifle all your heartaches, till it's safe again to cry. And when at last the darkness clears and the sun comes shining through, will you dust yourself and start it all anew? And you
She's a child now of her own. She's waiting to collect and take her home. But sometimes in the firelight, in the silence where she sits, her mind goes back to Bethel Street, to the darkness and the bliss. But she knows if there's another one, the end will be complete. I wonder what they'd say in Bethel Street. Sister will be dancing.
evacuation. The destruction that could be inflicted by the German Air Force have been dramatically illustrated by their attack on Guernica in support of Franco in the Spanish Civil War. Consequently, there was great concern for the British cities when war was declared, and plans had been made to evacuate. The day Hitler invaded Poland, the 1st of September 1939, evacuation began. In all, a total of 3.5 million children were evacuated with no casualties. Middle-class parents, accustomed to shooing their children out of sight and reach at the earliest possible age, were astonished that working-class parents from Liverpool had never worn knickers. Many families did not have suitcases, so the children carried their belongings in a pillowcase. The process at the destination could be devastating. One woman recalls, "We were told to sit quietly on the floor while the villagers and the farmers' wives came to choose the children they wanted. Pretty and attractive ones went first. And I noticed boys of 12 went very quickly, perhaps to help on the farm. Eventually, Nancy and I were the only ones left. Two plain, straight-haired little girls wearing glasses. When Rita Fried, a Jewish child, arrived at her foster home, the woman began to look in her head. Rita said, 'We've got Kleenex. What are you looking for?' And she said, 'I'm looking for your horns.' A reference to the belief of many at that time that Jews were the children of the devil. Many children were unhappy and ran away, trying to get home, as the next poem will show. There was no check on people taking children, and abuse was not uncommon. Homes taking evacuees were paid 10 shillings and sixpence per week, the equivalent of 53p today, for the first unaccompanied child, and 8 shillings and sixpence, 43p, for any subsequent children. Doctor's fees would also be paid. The first year of the war saw very little bombing, so many children returned home. Schools had been closed following the first evacuation, and the children ran wild when they came back home. When the Blitz started, many were evacuated a second time. Evacuation mixed the classes up as never before. It opened the eyes of many working class children to the advantages enjoyed by a few. Class system began to bend, heralding the changes that would be introduced after the war, including the welfare state and the NHS, changes desperately needed. An army of children, labelled, clutching tiny bags, came out of the dark and pricked a nation's conscience.
Born in 1893, Edith Pickford trained as a midwife and maternity nurse. As a member of the Voluntary Aid Detachment, VADs, she was involved in treating ailments of evacuees. The slum had been his home since he was born, and then war came, and he was rudely torn from all he'd ever known. And with his case of mean necessities, brought to a place of silences and space, just boom of the sea and sough of wind, Small wonder then that he crept out one night to see his sordid slum, and thought to find his way. By dawn he'd come a few short miles, and cattle in their herds gazed limpidly as he trudged by, and birds just stirring in first light awoke to hear his lonely sobbing, born of abject fear of sea and hills and sky, of silent night unbroken by the sound of shout and fight.
Conscription of Women. In 1939, for a second time, Britain found itself embroiled in international conflict, and women stepped forward to work in civil defence, armed forces and industry. Unlike any other country, for the first time, British women were conscripted into service. On the 18th of December 1941, the National Service Act required all women between the ages of 20 and 40 to register for wartime work. Later, this would be extended to ages 19 to 50. By mid-1943, almost 90% of single women and 80% of married women were employed in essential work for the war effort. These women took entirely new jobs, replacing the male workers who joined the military. Over 640,000 British women served in various auxiliary services of the British Armed Forces. They also played a vital role on the home front, running housekeeping. After working long hours in the factory, they had to queue for their ration shopping, cook a meal at home for their children, and then continue with housework and bending clothes and cultivating food in allotments and gardens.
An old-timer's growl. The following anonymous poem appeared in a Works magazine in 1944. By this time, women were firmly established as an integral part of the paid workforce of the country.
There's lipstick on the drinking cups. There's talcum on the bench. There's cold cream on the surface plate. Hand lotion on the wrench. A soir de Paris scents the air that once held blue boils smell. I've just picked up a curling pin. Believe me, war is hell.
Wilfred Wilson Gibson was born in Hexham on the 2nd of October 1878. He is more closely associated with the First World War and was a close friend of Rupert Brooke. He was Brooke's literary editor.
Shells by Wilfred Wilson Gibson. Hour after hour, to earn the wage to keep her and her little son, all day, hour after hour she stands, handling cold death with calloused hands. She does not think, she dare not feel what happens to shells that she handles and checks so carefully, of what within each case of steel is packed as, hour by hour, she stands, handling cold death with calloused hands.
There was a lighter side to factory work, and the thingy-bob was performed by Gracie Fields. So this is with apologies to Gracie Fields.
I can't pretend to be a great celebrity, but I'm still quite important in my way. The job I have to do may not sound much to you, but I am very proud to say I'm the girl that makes the thing that drills the hole that holds the spring, that drives the rod, that turns the knob, that works the thingy bob. Always a ticklish sort of job, making a thing for a thingy bob, especially when you don't know what it's for. But it's the girl that makes the thing, that holds the oil, that oils the ring, that makes the thingy bob that's going to win the war.
Monstrous Regiment by Alice Coates. Alice Coates studied at the Slade, and during the war she was in the Women's Land Army. She wrote 7 well-regarded books on horticultural themes as well as painting. Her poem with this title recalls a diatribe by John Knox against the rule of Queen Elizabeth I and Mary, Queen of Scots.
What hosts of women everywhere I see. I'm sick to death of them and they of me. And reigning men are small and pale. War lends a spurious value to the male. Mechanics are supplanted by their mothers. Ants take the place of artisans and others. Wives sell sago, daughters drive the van. Even the mansion is without a man. Females are farming who were frail before. Matrons attending meetings by the score. Maidens are mending multiple machines, and virgins vending station magazines. Dames, hoydens, wenches, harridans and husses, crammed to congestion all the trams and buses. Misses and grandmas, mistresses and nieces, infest bombed buildings, picking up the pieces. Girls from the south and lassies from the north, sisters and sweethearts bustle back and forth. The newsboy and the boy who drives the plough, postman and milkman are all ladies now. Doctors and engineers, yes, even these. Poets and politicians, all are she's. The very beasts that in the meadow browse are ewes and mares, heifers, hens and cows, all doubtless worthy to a high degree, but oh how boring, yes, including me.
Motor gone, we will still carry on.
Sergeant Major, tuck me in my little wooden bed. We all love you, Sergeant Major. When we hear you calling, show
up. Don't forget to wet me in the morning and bring me up a nice cup of tea.
Charge, 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 kiss me goodnight, Sergeant Major.
Hawarden Airfield was set up as a relief landing ground at the very busy fire training establishment at RAFC. By 1939, one runway had been laid, and by 1941, two more had been added. In December 1938, work began to build a factory on the airfield for the production of the Vickers Armstrong Wellington bombers. It was completed in 9 months and was fully operational by the time war broke out. As the war progressed, RAF Hawarden became one of the busiest airfields in the UK. The site not only had the Vickers factory, but also an aircraft maintenance unit, an aircraft ferry pool, and the only Spitfire training school in the country at the time of the Battle of Britain. Several well-known Battle of Britain pilots were trained at Hawarden, including Johnny Johnson, Schoolboy Berlin, and Ginger Lacey. Notable wartime visitors to the airfield included King George VI, Queen Elizabeth, and the American General George Patton. The Vickers factory was kept very, very busy, building over 5,500 Wellington bombers and 235 Lancaster bombers. One of the Hawarden aircraft is the last remaining flying Lancaster and can often be seen at air shows in the country and on special occasions, royal weddings. Nearly half of the 6,000 wartime workers were women. They stepped into the breach left by the men who had been called up for military service. During the war, many skilled construction workers were sent abroad, so very few homes were built during the period of conflict. This, combined with the bombing destruction and the post-war rise in the birth rate, led to a massive housing shortage. The Vickers factory responded to this by building over 11,000 aluminium prefabricated houses. The prefabs were originally designed to last for 10 years, but some of them are still occupied today, over 17 years later. In fact, some of them have been listed as historically important buildings.
I'm reading this on behalf of Sophie Roberts, who is unable to attend as she has a very bad back. Canadian War Graves. I have walked past the war graves in Hawarden Churchyard many times, but now I look at them in a different light as I have adopted two of them, John known as Jack Nolmine and Harry Womack. In April, by sheer chance, I spotted an unusual appeal online, headed with a photo of St. Daniel's Church, for one kind soul to find two graves and take a rose on the 1st of July to mark the anniversary of the death of two young men who were killed in World War II. I was so intrigued, I went there and then to the graves, found them, took photos, and sent them to the website to forward to this unknown person. The next day, I received an ecstatic email from Ontario, Canada, from Greg Branch, who was searching on behalf of his mother and had promised her he would trace the graves, but he knew only the name Hawarden. He hadn't held out much hope and had resigned himself to not receiving a reply. Sadly, his mother had died shortly before I was put in touch with him. Here the coincidence is remarkable. I had been in a similar position years earlier when I promised my own mother that I would find where her beloved cousin, Dennis Martin, Bomber Command, who grew up with her in Hawarden, was buried. My mum had died before knowing where his grave was. On July the 1st, I planted a rose bush, American and Canadian flags, and Reverend Andrea conducted a beautiful and moving service. John Milnine was a 19-year-old Canadian pilot, and Harry Womack was his 22-year-old American pilot instructor, stationed at Hawarden 47MU, and were killed together whilst training. Hands across the sea takes a whole new meaning.
Jan McTeer is about to recite the poem For Johnny, written by John Putney. 1940, John Putney was commissioned into the Royal Air Force as an intelligence officer and as a member of the Air Ministry's creative writing unit. This poem featured in the 1945 film The Way to the Stars.
For him in after years. Better by far for Johnny the bright star to keep your head and see his children are fed.
John Gillespie McGinn was an Anglo-American poet with a passion for flying. As soon as he was old enough, McGinn joined the Royal Canadian Air Force and trained as a fighter pilot. His love of flying was movingly recorded when, in September 1941, he composed arguably the most famous RAF poem that's ever been written. He entitled it High Flight and sent a copy to his parents in Canada. Just 4 months later, his Spitfire was in a collision with another aircraft and he crashed to his death. He was just 19 years of age. Meg John will now recite High Flight.
Early bonds of earth and dance the skies on laughter silvered wings. Sunward I've climbed and joined the tumbling mirth of sun-split clouds and done 100 things you have not dreamed of. Wheeled and soared and swung high in the sunlit silence. Hovering there, I've chased the shouting wind along and flung my eager craft through footless halls of air. Up, up the long, delirious, burning blue, I topped the windswept heights with easy grace, where never lark or ever eagle flew. And, while the silent, lifting mind, I've trod the high, untrespassed sanctity of space. Put out my hand and touched the face of God.
The Lancaster bomber had a crew of 7. Pilot, flight engineer, front gunner who also acted as the bomb airman, navigator, radio operator, mid-upper gunner, and tail gunner. Bomber crews were generally formed at informal get-togethers, where the young men mingled and sorted themselves into the appropriate groups. As their training progressed, they bonded into a team, which could likely be called a band of seven brothers. At the outbreak of war, young Ken Bonner, like so many of his compatriots, wanted to join the Air Force and do his bit. He volunteered for air crew duty, and on completion of his training, he became a tail gunner in a Lancaster. In the air, Ken was separated from the others because of his station in the rear gun turret. The turret was the most inhospitable part of the aircraft, being cold, sometimes colder than minus 30 degrees. Lonely, very drafty, it was so cramped that tall gunners often had to remove their boots to climb into their turrets. There was no room for a parachute, when the gunners complained that the windows were misting up, the RAF responded by removing the windows. When flying at high altitude, the air was so rare that breathing apparatus had to be used at all times. Ken's only communication with the other crew members was by means of radio intercom. After several successful raids over Germany, Ken's aircraft was returning home one night from an attack on Berlin, and his oxygen supply developed a fault. He removed his right glove in an attempt to fix the problem, but was so overcome, he passed out. He was rescued by the crew, but by the time they noticed his glove was missing, his hand was suffering from frostbite. He lost all four fingers, and his war ended. On its very next flight, his Lancaster was shot down, with the total loss of the crew. All of his friends had gone. Ken said that the crew member he felt most sorry for was the man who replaced him. That young boy died among strangers. And I asked Ken how he felt about losing his fingers. He replied, "I felt very, very lucky. If I hadn't lost my fingers, I would have lost my life."
This is the second piece that Sylvia Roberts wrote. It's about Dennis Philip Martin, Bomber Command. I never knew Dennis, although I know so much about him, I feel I did. He was my mother's first cousin and had been brought up by my grandmother and aunt in Hawarden, whilst his parents were working in Buenos Aires. Schooling in Argentina in the 1930s was poor, so he was sent home to his mother's two sisters who shared his care. From when I was little, I was told about Dennis, who flew with Bomber Command and was killed at 21. At the same time, I wasn't old enough to understand my mum's grief or why she cried when she spoke of him. She used to say that perhaps he had parachuted to safety and he was on the run in Germany. I realise now that clinging to that desperate hope must have given her some comfort. I promised I would find him, but she died before I could achieve this. There were no computers and I had never heard of the Commonwealth War Graves Commission. I didn't know where to start. Eventually, as information became easy to access, and with the generous and kind help from the CWGC, I found him. Too late to give my mother the joyful news, which will always be a source of regret, but still, he was found. Dennis is honoured here today in church on my exhibition board and on the cenotaph. My daughter took me to Berlin, where he, and the five members of his crew lie side by side in Charlottenburg War Cemetery, in beautifully tended grounds. War causes unspeakable suffering for thousands of others.
One of the foremost poets of the Second World War, Keith Douglas is best remembered for poems describing his experiences as a tank commander in North Africa. He fought with the 8th Army from Alamein to Tunisia, but was killed in the invasion of Normandy.
How to Kill, by Keith Douglas. Under the parabola of a ball, a child turning into a man. I looked into the air too long. The ball fell in my hand. It sang in the closed fist. Open, open. Behold a gift designed to kill. Now in my dial of glass appears the soldier who is going to die. He smiles and moves about in ways his mother knows, habits of his. The wires touch his face. I cry, now! Death, like a familiar, hears and look, has made a man of dust, a man of flesh. This sorcery I do. Being damned, I am amused to see the centre of love diffused and the wave of love travel into vacancy. How easy it is to make a ghost. The weightless mosquito touches a tiny shadow on the stone. And with how like, how infinite a likeness man and shadow meet. They fuse. A shadow is a man when the mosquito death approaches.
Alan Lewis is probably one of the best known English language poets of the Second World War. He was born near Aberdare in the South Wales and studied at the universities of Aberystwyth and Manchester. He first worked as a journalist, but soon turned to teaching. He had no desire to kill and considered registering as a conscientious objector, but he finally enlisted in the army in March 1940 in the Royal Engineers. Subsequently, he was given a commission in the South Wales Borderers and went to the Far East. He died in mysterious circumstances in March 1944.
Lady in Black by Alan Lewis. Lady in Black, I knew your son. Death was our enemy. Death and his gun. Death had a trench and he blazed away. We took that trench by the end of the day. Lady in Black, your son was shot. He was my mate and he got it hot. Death's a bastard, keeps hitting back. But a war's a war, Lady in Black. Birth hurt bad, but you didn't mind. Well, maybe death can do just as kind. So take it quiet, the same as your son. Death's only a vicar, armed with a gun. And one day death will give it back. And then you can speak to him tidy, Lady in Black.
Thank you.
short and the tall. Bless all the sergeants and their bleeding sons. Bless all the corporals and their old sons. And we're saying goodbye to them all. Back to the billets they crawl. For you'll get no promotion this side of the ocean. Cheer up, me lads, bless them all. Bless them all. Bless them all. The long and the short and the tall. Bless all the sergeants and WO1s. Bless all the corporals and their leading sons. We're saying goodbye to them all. Back to the billets they roll. For you'll get no promotion this side of the ocean. Cheer up, me lads, bless them all. Now they say there's a troop ship leaving Bombay, bound for O'Brien to show. They say it's full of tired young men, bound for the land they adore. There's many a sailor that served out his time. There's many a twerp signing on. For you'll get no promotion this side of the ocean. Cheer up, me lads, bless them all. Bless them all. Bless them all. The long and the short and the tall. Bless all the sergeants and WO1s. Bless all the smugglers and early sons. And we're saying goodbye to them all. As back to their billets they crawl. For you get no promotion this side of the ocean. Cheer up, me lads, bless them all.
The Arctic Convoys. On the 22nd of June 1941, the German armies launched their assault on the Soviet Union. The British Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, pledged his support to Russia and the Russian people. The first convoy sailed from Scapa Flow on the 21st of August 1941 with six merchant ships loaded with raw materials such as wool, rubber, tin, etc., in addition to 15 crated Hurricane aircraft, and escorted by six destroyers, one carrier, and two cruisers. The route they sailed was fraught with danger, as it passed through a narrow funnel between the Arctic ice pack and German bases in Norway. Convoys faced almost constant threat from German submarines, aircraft and warships, including the German battleships Scharnhorst and the Tirpitz. Conditions were amongst the worst faced by any Allied sailors. As well as the threat of attack, they faced extreme cold, gales and ice pack. The loss rate was higher than any other Allied convoy route. Between August 1941 and May 1945, around 1,400 merchant vessels escorted by ships of the Royal Navy, Royal Canadian Navy, and US Navy made the journey, delivering more than 4 million tons of supplies to the Soviet Union. 85 merchant vessels and 16 Royal Navy ships, two cruisers, six destroyers, and eight other escort ships were lost during the convoys, and more than 3,000 Allied sailors and servicemen died. Convoy PQ-17 suffered the worst casualties out of all the Arctic convoys. The convoy departed Reykjavik, Iceland, on the 27th of June 1942 with 36 ships. Of those, only 11 arrived at Archangel in the the Soviet Union. 2, returning to Iceland. And 23, lost.
Pigtail. When all the women from the transport had their heads shaved, 4 workers with brooms made from linden twigs swept and gathered up the hair. Behind the clean glass lies the stiff hair of those gassed in the gas chambers. There are pins and bone combs in this hair. No light shines through it. No breeze parts it. No hand touches it. No rain. Nor lips. In giant chests clusters the dried out hair of those gassed, and an ashen pigtail with a little ribbon pulled on at school by naughty boys.
Martin Neumüller, 1892 to 1984, was a prominent Lutheran pastor in Germany. He emerged as an outspoken public foe of Adolf Hitler and spent the last 7 years of Nazi rule in concentration camps. He is best remembered for his post-war words. First, they came from the socialists, and I did not speak out. The quotation expresses Niemöller's belief that Germans had been complicit through their silence in the Nazi imprisonment, persecution and murder of millions of people. He felt this to be especially true of the leaders of the Protestant Church.
First they came for the communists, and I did not speak out because I was not a communist. Then they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak out for me.
The Life That I Have by Leo Marx, MBE, 1920 to 2001. Marx was an English writer, screenwriter and cryptographer. During the Second World War, he headed the Codes Office, supporting resistance agents in occupied Europe for the Special Operations Executive. This poem, written in Christmas 1943 about a girlfriend who had recently died in Canada, was used as a cryptographic poem code. It was issued by Marx to Violet Jabo, a British agent of Special Operations Executive, who was eventually captured, tortured, and killed by the Nazis. After the war, Marx became a playwright and a screenwriter.
The life that I have is all that I have, and the life that I have is yours. The love that I have of the life that I have is yours and yours and yours. A sleep I shall have, a rest I shall have, yet death will be but a pause. peace of my years in the long green grass will be yours and yours and yours.
The Song of a German Mother by Bertolt Brecht, 1898 to 1956. Born in Augsburg, Germany, Brecht served as a medical orderly during the First World War and was appalled by what he saw. He was a well-known poet and prolific playwright with Marxist views, which would stay with him throughout his life. He fled to France from Nazi oppression and subsequently to Scandinavia and then the USA. He returned to East Germany following interrogation by the Un-American Activities Committee. His plays, Mother Courage and Her Children, and The Caucasian Chalk Circle are well known. But the lyrics of the song Mack the Knife from the Threepenny Opera are even better known.
Song of a German Mother. My son, your shiny boots and brown shirt were a present from me. If I'd known then what I know now, I'd have hanged myself from a tree. My son, when I saw your hand raised in the Hitler salute that first day, I didn't know those who saluted would see their hand wither away. My son, I can hear your voice speaking of a race of heroes it tells. I didn't know, guess, or see that you worked in their torture cells. My son, when I saw you marching in Hitler's victorious train, I didn't know he who marched off then would never come back again. My son, you told me our country was about to come into its own. I didn't know what it would come to was ashes and blood-stained stone. I saw you wearing your brown shirt. I should have protested aloud, for I did not know what I know now. No, it was your burial shroud.
Where have all the young men gone?
young girl's gone. Long time passing. Where have all the young girls gone? Long time ago. Where have all the young girls gone? Gone to young men, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the flowers gone last time? Where have all the flowers gone? Long time passing. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the flowers gone? Come to the young children world. When will we ever learn? When will we
Japan had been at war with China since 1937. In 1941, the United States of America put restrictions on trade, and this led to Japan declaring war on the USA and the British Empire, who were seen as active supporters of China. The British Empire included Hong Kong, Singapore, and Malaysia, and consequently, British forces became involved in conflicts in these areas. In Japanese culture, surrender was disgrace and meant that those involved became non-persons and were treated accordingly. Nearly 140,000 Allied military personnel were captured by the Japanese. These were forced to engage in hard labour, constructing roads, railways, airfields. About 36,000 were transported to the Japanese mainland and compelled to work in coal mines, shipyards, munition factories, and by the time the war was over, a total of more than 30,000 prisoners of war had died from diseases, starvation, and mistreatment, both within and outside the mainland. The experiences of some of the men and families involved are related in the following narratives.
Some memories of the late Judy Williams, a resident of Hull. Throughout their early childhood, Judy Williams and her younger brother Bruce saw little of their parents, because their father was the managing director of an import-export business, which was based in Singapore. The children were placed in British boarding schools. Judy was 11 years of age when the Battle of Britain began, and her parents decided that the children would be safer if they were with them in Singapore rather than in England. Soon after their arrival, there were threats of Singapore being invaded by the Japanese. So the children were found passage on a ship bound for Australia, in the charge of a remarkable 18-year-old girl. Soon after this, the Japanese attacked Singapore, and their father was made a prisoner of war in Changi Prison. Anxious to find her children, Judy's mother managed to embark on the last ship to leave Singapore for Australia. She arrived in Fremantle, not knowing where her children were, or even if they were still alive. By sheer chance, while sitting with a friend in a Perth cafe, she overheard a woman talking about a group of British children who had arrived by ship in Sydney, 2,000 miles away from where she was. This extremely resourceful woman quickly set off across the continent in the hope that their children would be among them. And within a few months, she managed to track them down. The trio then moved to Melbourne, where living conditions were much improved. Judy took up a keen interest in horse riding and soon became an accomplished horsewoman. When the war ended, Singapore was retaken, Judy's father was released, and the family returned to England. You can read more of this remarkable lady on one of the display boards in church.
My father, Roy Ellis, was a captain in the Royal Indian Army Service Corps. He fought in Burma in the Burma Campaign of 1942-44, alongside Indian, Gurkha and Commonwealth troops, all part of the Forgotten Army. He brought back his cookery as his tribute to the loyalty and bravery of the Gurkhas. I still have the cookery, but it's not on public display, I hasten to add. I know very little about my father's war. I never asked him about his experiences or his memories of his time in Burma, as I always got the impression that he wanted them to remain in the past where they belonged. However, over the years, I learned a few facts about his time in the Far East, how he would never forget finding, in a jungle clearing, the mangled remains of some Australian soldiers who had been captured by the Japanese, how he'd been sent to a hilltop station to recover after what he described as battle happy. On a lighter note, if you can call it that, he told the tale of a fellow officer who actually volunteered to go on the push to recapture Singapore, as he was anxious to re-establish his business there as quickly as possible. Intrigued, my father asked him what line of business he had been in. Rothels, he replied. That was not the answer my father was expecting. After the war, my father was mentioned in dispatches for distinguished service. He was awarded four medals, the War Medal 1939-45 for serving in the war, the Burma Star, awarded for service in the Burma Campaign between the 11th of December 1941 and the 2nd of December 1945. The Star, 1939-45, he was awarded this for operational service in World War II between the 3rd of September 1939 and the 2nd of September 1945, and for being mentioned in dispatches. And finally, the Defence Medal, the King's Commendation for Brave Conduct.
I am one of the lucky ones. Called up for army service in January 1945, I was trained as a wireless operator in the Royal Signals. In August 1945, both European and Pacific Wars were over, but I was posted overseas in October 1945. We set sail from Southampton and landed in Bombay, India. We were sent to a signal centre at Mao in Central Province, India, and after a few weeks acclimatization, we were posted to Java to join the 23rd Indian Division. The islands of the Dutch East Indies were by the Japanese in their conquest of the Pacific, and the 23rd Indian Division Signal Section had under their command a group of Japanese signalmen as prisoners of war. They were quite clever radio technicians, as we know, and one of the conditions of the Japanese surrender, the surrender terms, was that they helped in reparations in the countries they had occupied. In our case, they were used to repair and maintain our radio sets. Another condition was they had to stand and salute British soldiers of any rank. I could just about accept that if it was just a few prisoners. But on one occasion, I went to the docks area of Batavia, where about 100 prisoners working the stevedores stood and saluted me. I was a corporal at the time. I felt a little embarrassed. There was unrest in Java because the Indonesians were keen to break away from the Dutch and have their own independent state. They had formed their own unofficial army, a right tail, bob tail, as it was, and dressed in bright green uniforms, they walk about the streets fully armed with rifles, and believe it or not, some with hand grenades hanging by the pins from their belts. Uncomfortable to sit in a cinema with people like that. I thought they may get up and buy a chalk ice and blow the whole cinema on them. Our job was to provide radio communications for the road convoys which travel from Batavia to Bandung in the hills carrying supplies. We broke the journey with an overnight stay in the town of Sukabumi, which the Indonesians recognised as their centre of operations. They had erected a large portal over the road which stated, "You are now entering Republic Indonesia." The parking of our vehicles was a provocative move, and on several occasions, mortar bombs were fired at us as we were parked up. They also planted explosive devices in the road in their attempts to stop our progress. In the signals, we were not naturally a warlike crowd, so when our Japanese prisoners volunteered to head the convoy in their own truck, we were only too glad to accept their offer. We eventually left Java for Malaya, another country being encouraged by communists to ask for independence. Malaya, however, was reasonably peaceful, and the Indian division was disbanded, and I returned with them to India for the formalities. I served at the British Administration Centre in Jabalpur before being posted to New Delhi, where I had the unique experience of celebrating Independence Day with the Indians and seeing the birth of a nation, Pakistan. But then I had to observe the chaos of the migration which followed. My army service finished in February 1948.
My father, Albert Jones, was born in 1920. In 1938, he joined the Royal Army Medical Corps as a regular soldier. And on the 1st of November 1939, aged 19, he was posted to Bowen Road Military Hospital, Hong Kong, arriving in January 1940 as a medical orderly. The Japanese attacked the colony on the 8th of December 1941, just after his 21st birthday. In the confusion that followed, it took 3 weeks before, on December the 25th, General Maltby surrendered. Medical staff are classed as non-combatants, but on Crete, many of the RAMC unarmed staff were shot by the Germans, so it was decided to arm the men of the field ambulances, and they were issued with rifles, though they had little idea of how to use them. In the chaos of the fighting, the ambulance continued to pick up wounded men and return them to the dressing station. When they surrendered, they were all beaten by Japanese soldiers. They were more fortunate than they knew. They were not captured by Colonel Tanana's regiment, who took no prisoners. My father writes, "After being tied up, I was placed in a trench with my wrists very tightly bound and left. By the morning, I was very worried about my hands, as it had rained in the night and the rope had shrunk, and my hands resembled a pair of boxing gloves. I had the marks on my wrists for many years. After a further length of time, one of the Japanese soldiers cut me loose. I was taken by the Japanese and told to go and tell a small group of Canadians in a pillbox that they had to surrender. There was a tunnel leading to it with a right bend in it. A Japanese lay down with his gun and sighted it along the tunnel. I thought he was going to shoot me. At the bend in the tunnel, I had to turn right and run for it. I thought that if the Japanese didn't shoot me, the Canadians might, when they saw a figure rushing towards them. I felt a sharp pain in my elbow, and I knew I'd been shot. I think the shot had just been fired as I started to run, which caused it to hit my elbow rather than my back, as was intended. The Canadians put a dressing on it. At some time in the night, the officer, a British officer with a very posh accent, asked where the RAOC men was. There was a wounded man at the end of the passage calling for help and saying he'd been wounded. He didn't think he was English or Canadian, but he was sure he was one of ours. I was well aware of the Japanese tactic of pretending to be a wounded comrade and then killing you when you went to help. Nevertheless, I had no option but to go. I edged slowly down the passage towards the wounded man, hoping desperately that the Japanese would not choose this time for another attack. I reached him, and I was glad to find that he was Chinese. He'd been wounded in the legs. I tried to lift him, but he was much bigger than me. I began to drag him back down the passage, and as I passed our pillbox, I asked for assistance, but no one volunteered.
Perhaps best remembered for his 15 years as headmaster of Holland High School, Ken Hibbert spent much of the Second World War as a prisoner of war. When war broke out, Ken joined the Royal Engineers as a volunteer, and on completion of his basic training, he was posted to Greece. When I asked him what he was doing in Greece, he smiled and said running most of the time. During one eventful day, Ken was injured and dazed, and a Luftwaffe bomb exploded quite close to him. He lost contact with his companions and was then picked up by a German patrol. His captors took him to a hospital where his wounds were treated. On his third day in hospital, he managed to escape, but was quickly recaptured and interned in a prisoner of war camp in Austria, where conditions were dreadful, very little food. Ken's ability to speak German led him to be given special status in the camp as an interpreter. He was also given responsibility for the welfare of the prisoners. His most frightening experience was when he was interrogated by several drunken Gestapo officers who suspected that there was a hidden radio in the camp. Ken insisted that they search the billets, but was terrified that they might find something that he wasn't aware of. The most memorable day was when a shout went up, "The Yanks are here!" The American army had arrived fully armed. They arranged for Ken's group of prisoners to be flown to France before being airlifted back to England.
World War II memories of Lance Corporal Molly Harper, ATS, known to us as Molly Jones, a resident of Hawarden, now 97. I was 17 when the Second World War was declared in September 1939 and heard the announcement at 11 a.m. Matins in church in Colwyn Bay. Soon after, it was decided that children from Liverpool were to be evacuated and some would arrive in Colwyn Bay. The Girl Guide headquarters was the main assembly point, and as I was a guide leader, I was amongst the men given the task of collecting the children and taking them to the houses where they were to be billeted. During this time also, the Ministry of Food staff moved from London to Penrose College, Colwyn Bay, and the Inland Revenue took over the larger hotels in the Rose-on-Sea. A lot of my friends were joining the armed forces, and although I was in a reserved occupation as a conductor on the electric trams in Colwyn Bay, I decided to join the Auxiliary Territorial Service, now known as the RATS. So in December 1941, I left Colwyn Bay and went to the barracks in High Tone, Wrexham, for 3 weeks basic training, medical examinations, and inoculations. From there, I was posted to Chester to train as a switchboard operator, and was billeted with my friend with a family in Winsford, who owned a tea shop, and Mrs. Stubbs would always have a cup of hot chocolate ready for us at night time. Following 20 weeks training as a wireless operator, I was posted to Felstead Public School in Essex, to the headquarters of Eastern Command. There were many US personnel in the area, and the ATS had invitations to dances and entertainment at their base. Being close to London, we often hitched rides into the capital, and on one occasion, an RAF flat-bottom truck gathered almost 60 of us on the way. The whole unit was transferred to Newmarket in 1944, and our office was very busy with messages being sent and received in Morse code and being delivered by dispatch riders. I was still there when victory in Europe was declared in 1945. And joined in the celebrations and the parade. I returned home for a quiet life in 1945.
Last night I had the strange
and the people in the street.
has been given a bad name by Bertolt Brecht, translated by John Willett. A profoundly cynical and satirical comment on war and the actions of the German nation in World War II.
I am told that the best people have begun saying how, from a moral point of view, the Second World War fell below the standard of the First. The Wehrmacht allegedly deplores the methods by which the SS effected the extermination of certain peoples. The Ruhr industrialists are said to regret the bloody manhunts, which filled their mines and factories with slave workers. The intellectuals, so I heard, condemn industry's demand for slave workers, likewise their unfair treatment. Even the bishops disassociate themselves from this way of waging war. In short, the feeling prevails in every quarter that the Nazis did the fatherland a lamentably bad turn, and that war, while in itself necessary and natural, has, thanks to the unduly, uninhibited, and positively inhuman way in which it was conducted on this occasion, been discredited for some time to come.
Confession, let's hear it. We keep the welcome in the hillside. We keep the welcome in the vale. think now is the time for applause.
And makes all these things happen, and that's Joan. Come on down, Joan.
Oi, 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 oi.